Thank you, Sumit, for the kind introduction and also for the opportunity to speak in front of the August audience. So let's turn our page over to the malignant islet tumors. So just to give an idea, these are the main tumors I would be focusing upon today: sebaceous gland carcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, basal cell carcinoma, and malignant melanoma. Starting with sebaceous gland carcinoma. So if you look at the literature worldwide in differentials in India and in Asia, there is quite a disparity between the most common and the least common and commonly found islet tumors. Worldwide, if you do see in more of Caucasian population, that is United States, Northern Europe, the most common islet tumor would be quoted as a basal cell carcinoma, as against in Central Asia as well as India, the most common tumor found is sebaceous gland carcinoma. So sebaceous gland carcinoma arises from the glands of adnexa, meibomian glands, glands of Zeiss. Can also arise from the glands situated at the caruncle, from the glands in the fine hair follicles around the cutaneous aspect of the eyelid too. So all of these contribute to the periocular sebaceous gland carcinoma. Upper lid has more propensity as compared to lower lid and followed by caruncle in terms of frequency of location. Sebaceous gland carcinoma is also termed as the master of masquerade because it can hide in plain sight in form of recurrent calyzions or probably a chronic blepharoconjunctivitis. This delay in diagnosis and in-term management can sometimes increase the mortality rate up to 22% because of diffusely spread sebaceous gland carcinoma as well as systemic metastasis. It is also known to be found associated with some of the genetic disorders, for example, Moyator syndrome, which is autonomically dominant DNA damage genetic disorder. So what do I mean by the master masquerade? Now, here I have a picture of a 25-year-old female coming to me with a history of prior calyzion excision with also a lesion on her upper eyelid. I cannot comment upon it much at this stage, but as soon as I do avert her eyelid, I do see some of the sinister signs which tells me that this is not a recurrent calyzion. There is a feeder vessel present there. The posterior margin has been distorted. The vascularity has been increased. So this is how it kind of tends to fool us. Another example, so this is a 45-year-old lady coming to me with a mass in her upper eyelid, having undergone calyzion excision elsewhere twice or thrice without any prior histopathology. Subtle difference, not so subtle when you evert the eyelid. You can see some of the finer characteristics, for example, distorted posterior eyelid margin. The mass is firm, too hard to feel. Also, more importantly, the lesion is more, in the height of the lesion is more than the tarsal height, which is kind of a clue you should look for. I did explain to the patient what the suspicion is and what she needs to undergo, but she wanted to try Ayurvedic treatment or homeopathic treatment, some of the alternative medications. So this is her coming back to me after 6 months of the prior diagnosis. Now the diagnosis is no longer of any doubt. You can see a fully grown nodular variety of sebaceous gland carcinoma. And on eversion, the characteristics, intrinsic vascularity, feeder vessels, lots of eyelashes, distorted posterior eyelid margin with florid telangiectasia, and a firm to hard mass is visible. The other variant, apart from nodular, is a diffuse variant, which is also called as a pagetoid sebaceous gland carcinoma, happening because of the intraepithelial spread of the malignant cells, which is also found in around 50% of sebaceous gland tumors. It can be nodular, pagetoid, or a combined nodular with the rest of the tarsus being involved in the pagetoid spread as well. Pagetoid spread, in turn, increases the risk of local recurrence for sebaceous gland carcinoma. Looking at histopathologically, the classification includes well-differentiated, moderate, and poorly differentiated. Depending upon the growth pattern, it can be lobular, comedocarcinoma, papillary, or mixed characteristics. The characteristic stain, the fat stain, oilo red, can help you differentiate a sebaceous gland carcinoma. Talking about the high risk factors which increase the chances of local recurrence as well as systemic metastasis, large tumor size, the AJCC classification more than T2B, perivascular, lymphatic, or orbital invasion visible preoperatively via imaging or postoperatively on the histopathology. Presence of long-standing symptoms before diagnosis, poor differentiation characteristics on histopathology, multicentric origin in a single eye. How do they metastasize? So they generally metastasize hematogenically or through lymphatics to regional lymph nodes. Distant sites most commonly include lung, liver, bone, and brain. So I won't be focusing too much upon the investigations and management. Dr. Fairuz will later on cover up all of those aspects. Moving on to the next tumor, the basal cell carcinoma. This is another variety we do get to see in our OPDs, mostly in patients who have been farmers and have been doing outdoor activities for long period of time. The propensity for development, again, lower lid more than medial canthus, more than upper lid, and the last arising is lateral canthus. The risk factors include higher sun exposure or UV light exposure, advanced age, immunosuppression, prior radiotherapy, fair skin, and constant smoking. The incidence has been known to increase in systemic disorders, for example, xeroderma pigmentosa or Gorlin-Gall syndrome. The characteristics of basal cell would, I would say, they rarely metastasize, have in turn no low mortality per se because of the tumor, but they are highly locally invasive. Morphological types, again, nodular basal cell carcinoma, showing a painless, occasionally pigmented nodule with a fairly defined pearly whitish margins with central telangiectasia or peripheral telangiectasia. Central ulceration can occur in chronically with the rolled out margins. The other variety is the infiltrative or also called as morphia form. Here you can see the pale white or pink scar which sits like a plaque on the patch of the skin with irregular indurated edges, waxy and scaly surface. So how do these two look histopathologically? So the nodular basal cell carcinoma shows the peripheral palisading as shown here, and the infiltrative morphia form has a more horizontal spread in terms of the involvement of epidermis. Histopathologically speaking, the classification includes nodular, superficial, infiltrative or morphia form, or also known as sclerosing, micronodular or vasosquamous carcinoma. Now, this is an important slide for not only basal, more commonly basal, but not only basal, but also for squamous and sebaceous. Preoperatively, to check for the extent of the tumor or the invasion, you have to check for signs of perineural invasion, which include periocular paresthesias, frontal paresthesias, loss of motor functions, pain or anesthesia. Medial canthal basal cell carcinomas are more prone to orbital invasions or bony invasions. So what are the signs of an orbital invasion? You can sometimes see a visible or palpable mass in the orbit, the periosteal or bony fixity of the lesion, restriction of extraocular movements or a fixed globe, globe dystopia, mechanical ptosis. In terms of basal, again, talking about specifically basal cell, the incidence of metastasis is low, approximately less than 0.1%, but it is more for the vasosquamous variant of carcinoma, which has been reported to up to 14% in literature. The sites include lymph nodes, lungs, bones, and liver. Talking about squamous cell carcinoma in short, these are two pictures of advanced squamous cell. The risk factors, again, including similar factors, more importantly, radiation or chemical exposure, HPV infection, xeroderma pigmentosa. Morphologically, squamous can show a varied appearance from a small erythematous keratinized patch to papillomatous lesion to a large ulcerative lesions. They can be well circumscribed or poorly circumscribed, so your index of suspicion has to be there in your mind when you're looking at a probable pre-malignant or a squamous lesion. The differentials can be keratoacanthoma, as Dr. Menon rightly mentioned, or cutaneous horn. This also has a propensity to sometimes show orbital invasion with a direct tissue invasion or with a perineural spread, showing the symptoms of orbital invasion. Histopathologically, classically, you can see the keratin pearls, which are helpful in diagnosis of the carcinoma histopathologically. The predictors for local recurrence and metastasis for this particular tumor include the tumor size of more than 2 centimeter, depth of invasion of more than 4 millimeter, poor differentiation on histopathology, desmoplastic or adenosquamous subtype on histopathology, and also presence of perineural invasion. Okay, just a couple of minutes more, I'll cover malignant melanoma as well. So malignant melanoma is more common in Caucasian and fair-skinned people, but we do still get to see some of them in our Indian population as well. So out of cutaneous melanomas, perioculum melanoma are relatively rare, form less than 1% of the population. The risk factors include high density of prior presence of freckles or nevi in fair-skinned individuals with repeated IUV exposure. Morphologically, the types are divided into lentigo maligna melanoma, superficially spreading, and nodular. So the lentigo maligna melanoma is a slowly growing pale brown to black macular lesion with ill-defined margins or can show patchy pigmentation. Superficial spreading can be circumscribed, scattered, and palpable areas of irregular coloration. Nodular can show a nodule which can be blue, black, or brown with or without pigmentation. The classically described criteria for a cutaneous melanoma, which include A, B, C, D, E, to differentiate the benign component of melanocytic nevus or a melanocytic nevus to a malignant lesion, do apply for malignant melanoma of the eyelid as well, including asymmetry, irregular borders, dark, black, or varied color and contour, diameter greater than 6 millimeter, and evolving in size, shape, or color. The malignant melanoma has also been associated with nevus of Ota or a prior blue nevus syndrome. Quickly enumerating the other rare eyelid malignancies, you can apart from these four major malignancies which you get to see frequently in an oculoplasty or oncology clinic, you also sometimes come across sweat gland tumors, which are apocrine carcinomas or eccrine carcinomas arising from glands of Moll or sweat duct carcinomas, respectively. Other variant is another arising from a basal cell of epidermis, quite rare, but more common after immunosuppressive therapy as well as prior radiation therapy, arising from the basal cell of epidermis, the Merkel cell carcinoma, which is also known as cutaneous neuroendocrine carcinoma. All right, so I have tried to summarize the main malignant tumors, and I think Dr. Feruz will take it ahead with the management plan and options for all of these. Thank you for your patient listening.